Welcome back to Morning Express. It is now just about 15 minutes after 7 Kenyan time. It is time for The Way It Is, but today we are looking at it differently. Like I mentioned earlier, our usual panel today taking the day off, given that it's a holiday. Yesterday was May Day, the 1st of May, which is world over the day where laborers are celebrated. And of course, we have different ways of looking at this. There are those who feel they're not celebrated enough because celebration possibly for them would mean a pay rise. There are others who feel their bosses don't recognize what they do, and as a result, they go to work very, very lackadaisically, knowing that it is not something they look forward to. So today, of course, is a day that they're enjoying staying home, or we're enjoying staying home for various reasons. So today would like to address that. And as a laborer, as a worker, why are you going to work every morning? What is it that motivates you to wake up every morning? Is it something that you enjoy? And hopefully would like to finish the show this morning with you having better direction as to why you work. Now, joining me in the studio is Mbugua Mombi. Mbugua Mombi is a motivational speaker. He's an author and also a business consultant. Great, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Mike, and okay. Good morning.
Now, good morning. And after talking to several people, it has really occurred to me, and I think this is something that many of us will identify with, that we do not enjoy our work. Every day we wake up, it's almost like a punishment. The only thing that possibly makes us go to that work, many of us, majority, is the fact that at the end of the day, I have bills to pay, I have school fees to pay, I have things to take care of. So in short, if that salary was removed, then I would definitely not work. Whereas we are told the best way to be satisfied with a job, look for a job where you would actually do it for free, but still get money. So what should be our main motivation, and what causes us to have this negative perspective of work?
Thanks, Mike. You absolutely spot on. Research shows that 60% of employees hate their job.
60%? 60%.
That's by Gallup International. That's absolutely huge. And this is the number one challenge that employers and organizations have to confront each and every day. It is the number one cause of staff disengagement or underproductivity at the workplace. And the reason being that many employees, and I want to say this very humbly, and I know I am a former employee myself, many employees have the mentality that they are working for their employer or their boss or for their team or for their department. Many of us employees probably lack what I would call the big picture regarding their employment or their job. I think the most important question each and every employee ought to ask themselves every day until they get an answer is, why did I choose to be here in this organization? Mm-hmm. What motivated me, just like you have asked? Because then you realize employees are most motivated when they are new in an organization.
Precisely.
They're very motivated. Mm-hmm. But along the way,
something
happens. Mm-hmm. Number one, probably, they lose their why of seeking employment in that organization. And it is important for me to say this very humbly, that we as employees, we need to realize something. You chose, you applied to be in that organization, mm-hmm. to be on that job. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I make fun, Mike, and I say that no employee is in the organization, in their department, mm-hmm. with their boss through a court order. You chose to be there.
Nobody put a gun to your head.
Nobody put a gun to your hand.
Right.
You chose. Mm-hmm. But I think the challenge is along the way, you actually lose your motivation. Mm-hmm. You lose your why. Many employees do not have what you call the big picture of employment. Mm-hmm. My understanding, my personal view is this. Employment is a very privileged and noble opportunity for us not to earn money. Money ought not to be the primary motivation. The primary motivation, according to me, ought to be to earn life.
To earn life.
Wow. Yes.
But now, when I'm going to work, really, it is taking away my life in the sense that the 5 hours, 6 hours, 8 hours that I spend at my place of work is my lifetime that I have dedicated to this work in exchange for money. Are you saying that it should be different from that?
What I'm saying is this. What I'm saying is this: when we defocus primarily from earning money and we realize that our calling is to touch a life, I want to say this very, very emphatically. Every organization ought to realize something very, very important. Whether in production or service, the primary objective, the essence, the core business of every organization, every person, every company in business ought to be ultimately to uplift a life. Whether you are in transport, whether you are in the media like here, you're giving us information, you're giving us educative information and knowledge so that we can live with information that helps us to live better lives. Mm-hmm. So ultimately, every organization, the core business is to uplift life at the end of the tunnel. Therefore then, the employee ought to realize the same, that my primary responsibility, really, I wake up every morning to come here, not just to share news or to earn a salary, but because you realize one thing, whatever you are sharing with humanity, with people, they need it. If they did need it, you wouldn't be sharing it. Mm. And they need it primarily so that their life can get better. Mm-hmm. And therefore, every day, I am very privileged to go out in my employment and ultimately touch a life. However, of course, I expect compensation for that. I expect compensation. Mm-hmm. I expect that my time be, you know, complimented and compensated. And that is very, very important. Mm-hmm. But that becomes secondary. I'll tell you why.
Question, before you continue. Yes. What made us imagine mm-hmm. that our remuneration, or the main thing that takes us to work, is money? Where did we get that wrong? Because according to what you're saying, that should not be the main focus. So where did we go wrong?
Mike, that's an amazing question. Where did we go wrong? There are several factors that have contributed to this, right from our upbringing, our education system. Mike, let's remember when you were young, what were we being told by the entire society, from sometimes our mom, our dad, our brothers and sisters, our seniors, our mentors, our pastor? Go to school, study hard, get a good job, and a lot of money. Mm. So the primary motivation, the socialization, the focus was you work for money, which is very, very unfortunate. And we need to disabuse that notion. And that is why at the workplace, the commonest tag between an employee and an employer is about promotion and more money. Mm. And I need to see this. Employees need to realize one thing. This life is about self-promotion. It's really not about I waiting for my HR or my boss to promote me. Mm-hmm. Because promotion is all about results. And the truth is, Mike, if we can put it this way, if you're always the best member in terms of productivity in your team, every season, every year, you're the best. Mm-hmm. There's no way you can remain at the same position. Mm-hmm. So, Mike, we need to change the way we're mentoring our children and help them realize employment, by the way, is a school. How best can I explain employment? Can I use the analogy of the seed and the garden?
Please, go right ahead.
Yes, thank you. Mm. You take a seed, mm-hmm. say a grain of maize, you plant it in a garden, you connect it in the garden. When there is connection in the right garden, what happens?
It grows.
It grows. Mm. The power within the seed is ignited. Mm. The potential is ignited. Mm. The greatness within the seed is eventually unleashed. And where there was a seed, because there was connection and the right environment, very important parameters for productivity, then the greatness within the seed comes out. Where there was a seed, there's a tree and many fruits and so on and so forth. Similarly, and I say this very humbly, employment is a garden where Mbogwa Mombi, the employee, ought to go and get planted, connected in this school. And when you're well connected and you're motivated from within, what happens? Honestly, the power within you, the potential within you, the giftings within you ought to be seen, ought to be shared, ought to be unleashed in employment.
Okay, now this sounds very good, assuming that you're put in an environment where you, because from what you're saying, as the seed, the environment is conducive for you to germinate and grow and produce. But the real life situation that we're in today, and many of us find ourselves, is the fact that you didn't get that job because you liked it. Mm-hmm. It is situations, circumstances that led you there. Mm-hmm. And as a result, you ended up maybe, for instance, doing a job and you're getting your bills paid through this job, but you can't leave to get the job you love, because where else do you get a job? Circumstances forced you to take that job, not because you liked it.
Well, that's absolutely true. That many of the times you're engaged in something that we hate. But I want to bring out two things first and foremost. Number one, circumstances, the environment. Mm-hmm. It is my considered opinion, Mike, that the environment does not make a man. It is not the environment that determines who you are or how you should behave or respond. Actually, the environment only reveals who we are. Now, it is possible that you're in a job that you do not like, but where does the liking or not liking come from? It's a paradigm. It's an attitude. It's a mindset. And I really appreciate. I also find myself in engagement that I really don't feel very passionate about. But I can see primarily in 85% of the cases, it's really a matter of this attitude. If you really, because I may not like this. We may not, in life, we'll not always do what we like. But it is possible, Mike, with focus and a change paradigm, it is possible to attempt to try to like what you do. Mm-hmm. Why? Because, by the way, when you're engaged in something that you hate, you're the first victim.
Absolutely.
You start degenerating. Mm-hmm. You know, you are stressed. Mm-hmm. You're depressed. Mm-hmm. You're antisocial. You feel in the wrong place. Mm-hmm. Even your health is affected negatively. But having said that, then, what am I trying to say? Again, back to the structures that we have grown in, it becomes very important for us to try and establish as early as possible in our lives what our passion is, what our purpose is, what legacy we would want to contribute to this world, even in school, so that you're able to align your academics to what you want to do in life. Because you put it absolutely right, about 70% of people are in employment are not doing what they did in college, in the university.
Because that's the other tragedy.
And there's
You'll
a big
find
disconnect.
That we spend so much time in school, in universities, in learning centers, learning something which, one, we don't like. Secondly, we end up not doing. So what a waste of time.
Absolutely. And the challenge we have is this, unfortunately. But I need to appreciate that education was a very noble idea. Very noble idea. And the word educo, Latin, means, you know, unleashing, releasing, tapping from within. Unfortunately, the current system of education, and not just in Kenya, across the world, does not help you discover who you are. Let's use a very, very simple example, Mike. Take an egg, for example.
Yes.
And I say this very humbly. The potential for an egg to become a chicken, Mike, is within the egg.
Wait, I need to conceptualize that. The potential for an egg to become a chicken
is within the egg, true or not?
Okay, it's not without.
It's not without. The power is
just like the seed.
Number two, the formula that facilitates the egg to change from within, transform and become a chicken is also within. So both the potential and the formula are within. And that is why the egg does not go to school to become a chicken.
Wow.
Because it only needs what, Mike? It only needs to be incubated, nurtured in the right environment. Similarly, the potential for a human being to be great, to be productive, to live a life of excellence at the workplace is within. There is not a single human being in this world who cannot be a great performer, who cannot produce excellence, who cannot be able to live a life of excellence at the workplace. But unfortunately, sometimes the environment, like you said, for example, if the egg is not incubated in the right environment, it is going to die from within. And therefore then, the employer has a very, very significant, very cardinal role to play in as far as helping the employees, the workers, to bring out the greatness within them. So if you allow me then, I see the employer as an incubator of the greatness that the people have.
Within.
And if the employer is not using the right mechanisms or skills of the environment, that potential within the people then may wilt or may not come out. Absolutely.
Okay.
Yes.
So now, let's go back to the employee, because that's key.
Yes.
Looking at, for instance, the celebrations yesterday, there are many who left dejected.
Yes.
Because the minimum wage possibly was not touched on as they would have expected. And many of us possibly will find, and maybe I'd like to hear your comments on this, that we expect our employer to increase our wages for us to be happier. But the minute that happens, you realize you, within a short time, you again change to a point where you're thinking it's still not enough.
Wow. It's very true. Even as when I was working, I did expect every other time, every year during the appraisal, that my employer would certainly increase my salary or probably take me to the next level. But there's something that I need to say. The biggest challenge, the number one challenge really is not about employee and employer. The number one challenge is that we as employees, the employees, have not realized that they need to take charge of their destiny at the workplace. They need to take charge of their destiny at the workplace. Mm-hmm. Number one, the employer may not always review our salaries upwards. The employer may not always promote us for various reasons. Revenue versus cost and so on and so forth. Or probably lack of enough positions for you to be promoted to. But I think I need to say this with all humility. If an employee realizes, excuse me, I'm not just a mere worker. I'm not a mere employee. I, as Bugo Mumbi, I am a consultant at my workplace. Whether I am a tea boy, I am a tea girl, I'm in logistics, I am a cleaner, I am a consultant. And whatever I am doing, my big picture is not just, is not myopic. Yes, it's not about employment. A salary. Mm-hmm. My big picture is I need to grow and I'm responsible for my growth. And therefore, I will focus on building the consultancy called Bugo Mumbi, the consultancy called Mike. When Mike realizes, I'm not just here for a salary, he becomes a consultant. You perfect your organization called Bugo Mumbi International. You build your organization called Bugo Mumbi. By building your organization, do you know what will happen? Certainly, you're going to realize that your current environment or your current employer cannot contain your personal growth. Either they're going to promote you or, like a chick that is transforming from inside the egg, the very shell
that was holding
and protecting and giving security to the chick. If at day 21, the chick does not take action, spread its wings and its beak to crush the very shell, that very shell of comfort will kill you. Many of us are overstaying, sorry to say this with all due respect, in positions. Mm-hmm. Many of us are overstaying in one position, in one department, overstaying even in a company to say that, such that the very comfort, the very shell that you've been cocooned in becomes your death knell.
Wow. That is something. And for those of you possibly who may have a question, we can open up the phone lines now. We'll display the phone number. And if you have any questions that you'd like to ask Bugo Mumbi, feel free to do so. Now, Bugo Mumbi, one may sit here and think that possibly what you're saying is far-fetched and is out there. But you have a story. Tell me about your employment. Where did you start off from?
Thank you. After high school, I didn't go to the university. I couldn't make it to the university.
Was and that
I
really because hustled of funds a lot. Or because of grades?
I didn't manage the exact grades. Why? Because there's not a single term in high school where I was not sent home for the balance of the school fees. My mother was very poor. 11 children, single mother who was a barmaid, extremely poor. I thank the church who really aided me in terms of high school. But after high school, I actually hustled for almost 5 years. But my first corporate job in a multinational bank. My first corporate job in a multinational bank was a tea boy. And I loved the job. As a tea boy. It was in a bank. Mm. And I used to hear the cashiers every evening saying, balance your till, balance your till, balance your till of cash. I used to balance cups. I would say that, Mike. But I was motivated. I was very, very motivated. Because
what is it that gave you that motivation? And the reason why I ask that is because many of us possibly think the job we're doing, if I would just go to the next level, I would be much happier. But here you are happy at what many might scoff as, not a very nice job.
Thank you so much. Number one is because I knew exactly where I wanted to go. By the way, I started dreaming of working in the bank in class 5 when my mother took me to a bank in Thika Town. And I saw the bank and I saw money. And I asked my mother, is it possible for me when I grow up to work in this bank? Mm-hmm. She told me, God does not discriminate. It's your choice. So when I got the first job in a bank as a T-boy, to me, that was a great, amazing stepping stone. And I knew I was going to, it was the start of my ladder, climbing the ladder. Mm-hmm. I did for a few months. They realized, and I want to say this very humbly, Mike, very humbly. They saw my diligence, my commitment, my work ethics, my motivation, my passion. They actually had to seek dispensation from the head of office, HR director, for me to go through the interview process, even though I didn't have a degree or a professional certificate or diploma. But based on the output I gave, they requested HR, can this boy sit for the normal interview? If he passes, we give him a better job, a clerical job. If he doesn't, he remains a T-boy. Mm-hmm. So I did mathematics 2 hours, English 1.5 hours, and I passed. From a T-boy, I became a clerk. But I want to tell you something that one of the managers, he still arrived, told me. Because there was a time he told me, Mbugua, you are young, you're 2 years in this bank, we demand more from you. And I told my manager, excuse me, sir, you don't seem to understand. I come from a very humble background, blah, 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 blah. I have no degree. Some of my colleagues have a master's degree. I have none. Sir, can I ever expect to grow, to climb the ladder in this organization? Mr. Limo told me, excuse me, the most important degree, probably the only degree that matters in as far as success and self-promotion is concerned, and this degree is, it is a basic requirement. It is available in each and every human being. It's a minimum standard. That degree is called the heart. My own boss, he told me, Mbugua, open up your heart in selfless service to God and mankind. The rest will follow. Mm-hmm. He changed my life forever. He told me, how far you can go in this bank and how fast you can arrive is a personal choice. I said, what? Yes. It has nothing to do with whether you know a godfather here, how many degrees you have, your background. It has nothing to do with that.
That would some people say that it's downplaying education. Because at
not
the end
exactly.
of the day, you do require some minimum requirements for you to even go up that ladder. There are some things that you'll need that are academic.
Mike, I agree. Probably my boss wanted to tell me that you need to do what? You need to see how best you can harmonize this, bring them together to work for your own good. Why are we saying that? If you're not able to synchronize all those, and they're very important aspects of success. Because Mike, you can agree with me. We have somebody who is a professor today. But at their workplace, I'm so sorry, they're not as productive. That's with somebody who is just primary school dropout, mm-hmm. and their workplace, they're extremely, extremely productive. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you see that, even some of the gatekeepers that you meet at the gate, how they treat you, their passion, their love for the job, you're like, wow, they should have been the manager in this company, not so on and so forth. So that changed. And from that time, I realized it was really about, because really, motivation is not about what religion you are, Mike. Motivation is not about what tribe you are. Passion has nothing to do with how many degrees that you have. It has nothing to do with your height. It is something spiritual. It is inside you. Mm. And you can ignite it. You can bring it out. It's only that we didn't know that. Because, again, according to the way you have been cultured, we think motivation is what? Is extrinsic. Is material. Mm-hmm. Give me money. Give me a gift. Mm-hmm. Give me this and so on and so forth. But the most enduring motivation, might probably the only true motivation, it ought to be a seed that must be nurtured from within yourself. Within yourself. Mm-hmm. So Mike, I want to say that very humbly. So within about 7 years, I was a senior manager in that bank. Mm-hmm. Within about 7 years. Mm-hmm. Because somebody told me this. See yourself as a consultant today who is consulting with this bank. Mm-hmm. See yourself today as a consultant today who is consulting with this media house. Mm-hmm. And tomorrow you may be in a different media house. You see, I think to me, the workplace as human beings, let me use the analogy of an orange tree. If you think about a fruit tree, like an orange tree has a lot of gifts within it. You can get oranges, the orange juice, you can make charcoal, firewood, bats can build on it. You can rest under its shade and so on and so forth. It conserves the environment. There are so many that you can enumerate. So
just
many.
Just from that one orange tree.
Yes. Yes. Mm-hmm. And these gifts were endowed to the orange tree freely by its maker. And remember one day that huge orange tree was a seed, true or not? Too tiny, you could barely hold it between your fingers. Mm. But the seed agreed to unleash the power, the greatness within it, the right environment. But I think to me, the very cardinal question is, what is the orange tree supposed to do with those gifts? And the answer is only one, to share, to give, to spread, to distribute, to serve. And Mike, the more it serves, the more you as the owner of the tree, you invest in it.
Wow.
For some of us who grew up in the rural area, look at that tree, orange tree up there. If the tree was very unproductive, maybe giving only 3 oranges in a year, what would happen? The owner neglects it.
Or even cut it down.
Or cut down, or you tether your dog there, or you tether your goat there. But the tree that is productive, giving expected return value out of the investment, you ring fence it. You ring fence it because it has value.
Now, looking at it, because we're talking about employers and employees, I'm sure employers are probably at home clapping and saying, yes, keep going on. But employees, on the other hand, on the other side saying, no. Here I am giving so much labor. At what point will I be recognized? Maybe there are those who feel that, yes, I have done, like you're saying, I have given my all, I have done passionately. But another person who came from school the other day came and was even promoted higher than me. And what is it that I'm doing wrong? What would you say they're doing wrong? They have worked.
Wow. Let me talk about the employer. Because just like the seed and the garden, employment is a garden. If the garden is rocky, even if you have grade A seed, it will never give good returns. Because the ground is rocky.
The environment is choking the seed.
We have a very big challenge in many organizations, Mike, where sometimes even the business owners, the shareholders, the CEOs have not appreciated that the most important asset that they have
is the employee.
Is the people. I normally say companies do not grow. This building will not grow so that tomorrow it has another 8 stories. Cars do not grow. Our computers will not grow. It is the people who grow. And when they grow, they push the company to another level. It's like this jacket of mine. It will never grow. It is my body that grows. If I realize tomorrow the jacket is too small, I discard the jacket, put on another one.
Correct.
The greatest investment that companies have is the people. And companies must realize one thing. The only way you can be able to sustain excellence is by sustaining people development. You must focus on growing the people. You must focus on growing the seed. You must focus on nurturing the seed, watering it, and so on and so forth. Because what are you looking in the seed? The greatness within. What are you looking in with employees? The greatness within. They have the talents. They have the potential. It has to be brought out. And therefore then, most of the times, employees bypass that. Sometimes they want quick fixes. I mean, if you're having a long haulage truck, probably you're transporting your goods, tea from Mount Kenya to Mombasa, certainly, you need to ensure that your truck is serviceable. It's well done because it's carrying a very precious cargo. Companies do not realize that most of the times. But the way you realize, when it comes to the cases of reviewing budgets, the first item they look at in many organizations is training budget, slash it. It's like saying, I have a problem with this tree, and the first thing I want to do is cut off the water. What else do you expect?
How do you expect it to grow?
How do you expect it to grow?
How do you expect it to bear more fruit?
So people development becomes very key. And I think the biggest problem we have in organizations is not even the amount of salary. Sometimes it is very simple things, Mike. Appreciating the people in very small ways, being kind to them, dignifying them, giving them their due respect, appreciating them for their little or big contribution every day, treating people like people. There are quite a number of organizations where the number one challenge is sometimes people are not treated like people. You wake up in the morning today and you're told, probably today is a Friday, you're told by Monday you've been transferred to Mombasa, to Garissa. Sometimes we do not also think about the big picture, that this is not just a colleague I am working with called Mike. This probably is somebody's husband, is somebody's father or uncle. This is a human being. I am a human being like him. If I was in his possession, how would I want to be treated? That sometimes lacks at the workplace in quite a number of organizations.
And that can discourage the seed, what you're calling the seed, which is the employee. Let's address the employee, because I'm sure the employers who are saying, yes, I have done all that I can. I have created an environment. I am willing to reward. But especially in this day and age, you'll find that we have a generation of employees who expect so much from their places of work without giving, without pouring out what they have, without working as they would be expected to.
That is very true. We've quite a number of employees, unfortunately, and that is why we say the number one challenge is staff disengagement, who are not really engaged at their workplace. Maybe they're hoping that tomorrow, next day, they will not be in that company. Or they think they're in the wrong place. And therefore, would I say they're not passionate about it?
They're not committed.
Mm. They are merely complying to the bare minimum to keep themselves on the payroll. Mm. And this works to their disadvantage. Why? Because it is like a seed that you keep on uprooting. Eventually, it will not be firm. It will not be well connected. So employees ought to realize this, and this is very important. You cannot expect a return where you are not investing as an employee. Mm-hmm. You must invest your own energy. You must invest your own skills. You must invest your own performance in order for you to get a return. Because one of the things we must appreciate is that my employer will not be able to pay me if the company is not generating revenue. Mm. And I know one thing for sure. I know one thing. The more the revenue my employer generates, I know in most of the cases, probably with time, the more I also get to be paid. Because the company is growing and I'm growing. Mm. For example, if we had 10 people 5 years ago, today you have 100 people. Certainly, the dynamics, financial dynamics and team dynamics have changed.
Correct.
And similarly, I will be a beneficiary. Mm. So there are people who, and I think I need to emphasize this, who think I'm working for Mike because he's my boss. He drives a big car. He wears differently. He has a lot of money in the bank. We do not ask ourselves, where did Mike start? Where did Mike start? Most of us as young people, like you said, Mike, are not willing to delay immediate gratification for long-term success. Most of the reasons that we are underperforming or we are disconnected at the workplace is because you lack your personal career plan. A question like this would be very, very paramount to an employee. Where do I desire to be in this organization in the next, say, 5 years? Mm. Not where do I expect my employer to take me? Where do I desire to be? And I need to see this. Where you'll be tomorrow in your organization is a direct function of what you are donating. Because this life is never about duration. This life is not about donation. What are you giving today? What are you giving tomorrow? What legacy are you contributing to that organization? And especially realizing this as an employee, excuse me, I am not working for my employer. I'm not working for my organization. Mm-mm. This ought to be something bigger than my employer. My employer is not the paymaster general. To me, with all my faith and what have you, I believe I'm working for my creator. My big picture is I am working for my creator. My creator is my paymaster general. That is why, for example, my employer today can collapse. The company can die. But I still believe tomorrow I'll have another organization.
Form of employment.
Because my paymaster general can never die. Mm. Can never collapse.
Let's come back to your story. Because you mentioned that you started at a certain bank as a T-boy.
Yes.
And that was a desire for you. You looked at it as a stepping stone to actually work. You were already working in a bank. Only that you are not working in the kind of maybe job description that you had desired.
Yes.
Are you still working as a T-boy?
Great question. Probably wouldn't be here, Mike. I'm not sure that you would have invited me.
I'm not quite sure.
I actually worked as a T-boy for about 6 months. Mm-hmm. From there, I became a clerk. In 7 years, I was a senior manager leading the second biggest branch of that bank in this country.
In 7 years.
Mm-hmm. And I can tell you this. This is why I talked about taking charge of your destiny at the workplace. You can determine and decide where you'll be. I actually left employment. The chick was transforming from inside. And at some point, the shell had to break for the chick to come out. Mm. I left employment. My resignation letter was 1st of April 2008. And my subject of the letter was not resignation, Mike. It was the road least traveled. I wish I came with a copy, because I still have those copies. The road least traveled. Because I realized, and I need to say this, my employer had nurtured me. My employer had mentored me to a level where I realized, wow, now I need to break this shell. Go out and probably discover and become what my divine master created me to be. Discover my own purpose. That is why my letter was titled The Road Least Traveled. It made the biggest difference in my life, Mike.
What is it that gave you that courage?
Great question.
To take that step. There are many who possibly feel, I can do a lot more in a different environment. But we feel choked by the fact that possibly you're one, of course, there's fear, what may happen
absolutely,
of the unknown. But secondly, I don't know if it's going to be successful. What gave you that courage to actually take that step?
I think I would attribute this largely to what I would call self-awareness. Self-awareness. Realizing that, yes, like the example I use of an egg, realizing that I have the power, I have the potential, and I have the formula, and I can become the master of my own destiny. I can become the captain and the pilot. I can nurture the power within me. By that time, Mike, I started reading a lot of motivational books or self-help development books. I read a lot of books, and they told me, there's one particular message that kept on hammering in my mind, You're the master. You can do it. You have the power. You have the potential. You just need to align yourself and your God, your creator, and harmonize. And especially about the power of thinking, how you think about yourself. So what am I saying? I decided to restructure myself. And that is why also employees must appreciate. When companies are restructuring, it is for a good thing. It is not necessary to take you home. Because a company is also a person, is a personality. I restructured myself. I even changed my name. These were not my names a few years ago. I changed my name.
Why did you change
I rebranded
your name?
Because I was rebranding myself. Yes, I wrote books to rebrand myself. I created new avenues. I repackaged myself to be a different person. And that's made a big difference today. Big difference. The thing that I've done today, and I say this very humbly because I'm still struggling to discover who I am. I'm still in that, I'm works in progress. But there are things I've done over the last 6 years or so that probably I would never have done in my lifetime if probably I didn't realize I had the power. Like writing books, being an international motivational speaker, having a training organization, Success Signature. We now train companies, leadership, customer service, team building.